Hi guys and welcome, I'm Chevalier, glad to have you with me watching the initial situation of Portugal. Portugal can be considered the little brother of Castile. They are basically the same thing as Castile, they have the same focuses, basically exploration and colonization, but they are smaller, which makes things a little bit difficult. They also don't have the good event like the Iberian wedding between Castile and Aragon, and Naples, which comes with the Aragon Union, which makes Castile very easy to play. You can check out the Castile video like 2 days ago, probably should have in the playlist. It's episode number 2. Now, let's talk about Portugal. Their initial situation, it's a little bit bad, to be honest. They are cramped here, although they can expand and colonize. Let's go for the TI first to see. There we go. Although they can expand and colonize to Cape Verde, it makes it a little bit difficult to do due to their lack of money. Basically, they cannot actually sustain that many colonies. They can sustain one, maybe two, and then they're gonna slow it down. Also, in these new patches, the liberty desire of your colonies is gonna affect you pretty badly, to be honest. Like, if you have a colony in Brazil, one in Caribbean, and one in Mexico, they're basically gonna have close to 18 troops in total, and you have 16 troops, 70 troops. You can build 70 troops, so they have 16, perhaps maybe 14, let's say, but they will still have plenty of troops to actually declare war on you, especially if they have support from one of your rivals. So basically, Portugal, at the same time as expanding and colonizing, they have to expand their land pretty aggressively. Now, we'll talk about where to expand and when to expand in the later segment. I will talk about maximizing their initial stats of Portugal. Basically, as in all playthroughs, you must maximize the states. You can go for the support and recruit an inquisitor. You'll need this because you'll want to remove the sunny religion from these areas here, which you might conquer. You will maybe an 80% chance that you'll conquer Granada, and 100% chance that you'll conquer some lands from Morocco, mainly because you'll get a mission for Tangiers, and Tangiers is a coastal center of trade. But we'll talk this for in about 30 minutes perhaps. Now let's go to the nobility. You'll want to recruit a minister. This is gonna give you a 65, and you also want to call a diet for them to be happy. They're at 75, it's a bit risky, but it still holds off. You'll want to grant monopoly charters. You'll also want to switch estates to clergy, because you get a local unrest minus 2 and diminution strength plus 2, which is really gonna help you. Now, let's see. You might actually want to basically give Algrave to the estates. It's recommended if you want to have access to the burgers. I will actually not do it right now. It's not that important, to be honest. You'll want to give one of these lands that you take, probably Garb. If you take Garb and Tangiers, you'll get a separate mission for Garb, if I'm not mistaken, to get this whole region here. Yeah, this whole region of what's it called? Region Maghreb area and North Morocco. So for this region here. Now, let's go back to the states. You don't have anything to get here. If you get Algrave, you'll get 39.9, if I'm not mistaken. Let's see. Yeah, 39.8 is not gonna get you over 40. That means you have to give them another province, which is not gonna be worth it. Too bad for you. But keeping them like this should be good. you'll also want to take the demand administrative support and demand military support, as well as ask for demand diplo support when their happiness goes down. Basically, you know why, because you want to maximize your stuff. It's pretty straightforward. Now let's go to government. Your leader is Infante Pedro. He's infant. Infanto means infant in Portuguese. Also in Spanish, Romanian, and French, I think. Yeah. In Italian, I think. Yes, infante means child, basically. Now, he's a regency. You have a decent regency. He has a 3-2-2. It's really crap. He should die as soon as possible, so make him into a general when he's of age. You'll want to go for national focus admin points, because you want the admin points. You'll take the Inquisitor here with the plus 2. You also get the better resources over time for the plus 2. And you'll get from here, I will tend to go for national for land force limit. It's really good right now. You'll get the plus 2, so you'll probably reach 19 or 18. Also, you can go for the national manpower, although I tend to make Castile take the brunt of the damage. It's still up to you. But let's go for now for the national manpower guy. And this is all. Diplomatic wise, you'll only rival Morocco for now. This is all. You could also rival Tunis, but they usually ally the Ottomans. It's gonna be a little bit difficult. Okay, do I have Yes Man on for some reason? Let's see. No. They are disabled, so. Why did you rival in Byzantium? It doesn't really matter. Fuck it. Now let's see. Only Morocco for now. Later on, you'll probably want to rival Castile, etc. It's a little bit in the future. You'll also want to take an alliance with Castile. And you will want to fabricate claims on Granada. So you'll do this. Now let's go again. This should be it for now on this tab. You'll want to... We'll talk about the later enemies in a couple of minutes. On the economy tab, of course, kill the maintenance, kill the forts as well, and you'll see that they're making 0.06. If you switch these ships to... Let's see... You want to have this, and select this to protect trade. This other half, you'll want to send them to explore. And you want them to explore. Really? Oh, I have TI. Oh, I have TI. Sorry. If you don't have TI, let's actually take TI off. There we go. And send them to explore the West African coast. And the rest of your ships, as well as with Castile, depends. You don't have actually cash to keep them in check, to keep them operational, so you should probably mothball them. If you for some reason have a surge of cash, you should probably use them to basically patrol the area around the civil train node. But for now, just mothball them, because you don't have the money. You'll want to... Actually, no, let's go back to the economy tab. This is it. Try to increase your trade and trade steering. Let's go for some trade steering. You push from Tunis and Safi for now. I actually, to be honest, recommend collecting Genoa. I know this sounds kind of not bad, but you'll see right now. You push here 0.52 to Seville, and you take only 32% from Seville. So basically, from the 0.52 that you push to Seville, you take only a third, so that means you take what, 17 ducats, something like that. Let's collect from Genoa and you'll see how much you get. Let's actually up the speed. Let's go to speed 4. So my PC won't crash. Okay. And it was, okay, 0.14. So, really? This little? Strange. Let's see, Portugal 1.4. Income 30%. Trade power. Strange. You should be able to make like 10 ducats from here, but I guess there are too many nations collecting here. Yeah, that's why. There are basically too many nations collecting here. In my Manchu campaign, I was collecting from the, what was it, the Hangzhou trade node, I think. No, the Hangzhou. The one in Beijing. And you'll get maybe 0.20, something like that. But they had only one nation there. So that's why. But still, keep it in Safi. You're gonna push a little bit. You already push up on 45. Yeah, it's keep it in Genoa because you already push automatically a little bit. Like you only miss 7 divided by 3. That will mean you lose 2 or something. And you make 4 here. You make plus 0.02 ducats. It's not gonna help, but you know, if you want to be that efficient. Now let's see. For the next step, trade or discuss trade. You can also take this. It's costly. You'll use it. It has some uses right now, but it also has disadvantages in this patch. As you can actually, if you check the what's it called, the patch notes several patches ago, you'll see that they state that mercantilism has the negative effects. Although I do not know what they are, they have negative effects. Tech wise, push that the admin points and save the diplo points. Take military techs when you need them. Like I'll repeat this, take military techs when they are needed and try to use as much of the ahead of time modifier, because they might take take four at the same time as you do, but you'll get a -5, so you're gonna save 30 points. You get 3. You have problems here with the military leaders, so you get 3. That means you save 10 months of points right now. If you kill one of your leaders, you'll save less. You'll save for what? 430 divided 7. You'll say for 7.5 months basically. Now let's go back to the tech screen. Try to rush 5, try to rush 7 as well, and try to manage your diplo points as much as possible, because this guy is gonna be on the throne for 50 years. Let's say 40 if you're lucky and he dies in a battle. If you're lucky and he dies in a battle. So you're gonna be strapped for points even if you maximize this with a +2/+2 and you have maximum power, you have 50 power projection, you'll still suffer some shit. Now let's go to ideas. Portuguese ideas are focused on trade and exploration. You should actually form Spain as fast as you can. After you conquer Castile and Aragon, of course, because you need tons of land. You need Barcelona, Zaragoza, Castilla, Viena, Salamanca, Seville, Toledo, Valencia, Granada. You need lots of land, so it's gonna be a while till you form Spain, but you should form Spain as fast as possible. Now let's go back to ideas. You have the trade efficiency, which is okay, I guess. It gives you more cash, although you don't have an end trade node, which you can use to the full potential. Trade range, the same, is pretty useless right now. It's gonna be useful in the late game, in the early game and mid game, but still you'll have to have somewhere to switch the trade from. And at the max you have global tariffs, which are good for the colonies, This is actually good. Sailors and colonial range is useful at first, especially the colonial range, and a little bit the sailors because you want to expand your navy to deal with the Castilian navy, but as the game progresses, it's gonna be useless. Goods produce, okayish, I guess, less than okay, to be honest. It's gonna give a little bit more cash, but still, not that great. Global trade power is decent, merchant it's okay, more than okay, I guess. Build cost is decent as well. You should try to build as much as possible before you form Spain. Global settler increase is decent, it's worse than Castile's though. And you have the trade efficiency plus 10%. As for ideas, you'll go for exploration, then expansion, as the same as Castile. Then you'll take whatever fits you the same as Castile. Either you go for basically an admin idea to get the core creation cost minus 25%, so you can expand more into this at a less cost. We'll talk about expanding later on, or core land from Castile, or if you want to go for the influence ideas, although they are really crap right now, to be honest, because the cost for diplomatic expansion, diplomatic annexation has been increased. Basically, if I haven't said this before, the cost for the diplomatic annexation, diplomatic annexation of a country, I guess, is calculated by the value of a land. So basically, the cost for diplomatic annexation of Porto is 190 divided by 2, because you have the 50% modifier, so that means you have 190, it means you have 95 points for the annexation of Porto, because they're a state. If there were a territory, it'll cost you full 190 to conquer Porto because it's a state, and half of it if Porto was a territory. Basically, this causes disadvantage for people who basically have lots of land. They are the max on territories, on states, and they annex some more. Basically, this makes it impossible to create more states, so basically those points are wasted. Though I would note that if you can make annexed territory that was a state into a state for free, if you know what I mean. It's a little bit tricky. I'll try to update the wiki. You can go there on the states. It should be updated by now, to be honest, I haven't checked it. Though it actually took me a little bit of calculation in the Manchu campaign to actually make sure that the cost was right, and not raise any questions or rant against Paradox. Now let's get back to ideas. The third idea, as I said, either admin to get an ability, influence ideas to the max if you want to use vassals, or a military idea. I would actually recommend quality ideas because you want to fight against Castile and Aragon, and they have more armies than you do, and you want to field more troops yourself to be able to deal with the colonies independence, basically. So they won't want to go independent from the start, because you'll have more land force limits and more troops to build, and also less cost for the troops you have, as you have maintenance modifier minus 10%. So if you want to go for a military idea, I recommend quality ideas for Portugal. It serves you very good. It serves you very well, I guess. Now, for the next step, decisions. You can form Spain. You have some like instituted the societies Jesu. This is your own. It's specific to Portugal. That's the only decision that I think you have in the whole game, if I'm not mistaken. You'll have some good events, mainly focused on trade and exploration, because of course you're Portugal. And for missions, you'll have conquered Tangiers, as I said. You'll also have conquered Garb. Conquering Tangiers gives you 200 admin points, which are gonna be more than enough to conquer Tangiers. Right now, Tangiers cost you 70 points, that's 35. I actually. So. The modifiers might cancel themselves out. The 50% from the actual formation of. For the making of a territory state, and the Berber traditions. I don't know if they add the. If they multiply, or if they simply add up. Like if they add up, they cancel each other, if they multiply, you'll have to find out which one adds first, but they should add themselves out, the multipliers. Because if they multiply themselves, they're gonna be a little bit complicated to calculate. And I said you'll have for Garp, you'll have a mission for Garp, as well, if I'm not mistaken. And that should be actually, if you lose Ceuta, you're gonna have a mission for Ceuta as well. Just to state that out. Now, Staten expansion, you'll have more separatists, you'll most likely also have tons of separatists while you move into these lands here. It's gonna be, to be honest, your problem, big problem for the rest of the game. Basically, these lands over here, you'll have to actually conquer them, and probably even take humanists to keep them down. And as well, you'll actually have to give clergy control over here, so you can actually convert them from Sunni to Catholic. Now, next tab is religion. As I said, you already have a missionary guy. You also have this thing given to the clergy, as you can see. So it's gonna be easy to, not easy, it's gonna be possible to convert it in, as you can see here, 77 months. That means what, 6 years, 6 year and a half. Let's actually see. It's gonna cost you cash, of course, because why not? And it's gonna give you 7 points of unrest, and it's gonna take 12 years to revolt. Still, this is kind of tricky if you actually do this also. If you boost ability for 95 points, it will actually decrease. Let's see, how much is it right now? Now 55, so less than 6 years. Because you have the points. If you get an event for stability, it's gonna be even greater. You can also take a decision here. Let's see, not this one. You need to take 8, you need to take 10. You need to have a theologian, and you can take this decision here. You can get a theologian from the clergy, recruit the minister, but you'll have to wait till your this thing, the influence goes down a little bit, so you can take the theologian. Try to convert as much of this as possible, and try to be efficient in converting. You'll also have to convert Granada and Gibraltar and Almeria if you take them. You also have to be. We'll talk about the conquest of Granada and what you should be careful of in a couple of minutes. Military-wise, I really don't know what to do with this guy. Recommended it'll be to actually fire this guy once you explore these lands. You can once you explore all you can is to fire this guy. You can also fire this guy, but I will need it to attack Morocco, and he has decent stats. We already talked about the states, and now let's go into your neighbors and avenues of attack. Basically, you will want to, as I did here, fabricate a claim on Morocco, or to get Tangiers, to get the mission to conquer Tangiers, and to get one for Garb. You'll have missions here. You might actually also want to take one more piece of land from them, if you can afford it. I do recommend taking Infi, or making your way to Talifat. Basically this. Making your way to Talifat, you, because of the gold here, it's gonna give you enough enough cash to sustain yourself if you get a gold, if you get a gold mine of Talifat. But still, this is maybe 20 to 30 years into the game until you can make it to Talifat with claims. If you want to take a straight line to Talifat, it's possible right away, although I'm not sure if you are gonna also be able to get the war operations and the humiliate rival. Now, let's see. Your main target should be Morocco. You'll take an alliance with Castile and declare war on Morocco while calling in Castile. They do not want any lands from Morocco. Now it's not possible because this guy is an administrator, so he won't be that aggressive. But if this guy is a different type of guy, if he's neutral or if he's aggressive, he'll want to take lands from Morocco. For me right now, it's not possible, so you shouldn't do it. You'll also want to attack Granada. You have a guy here. Now you're already building a spine over here. You'll want to get claims on Gibraltar and Granada, and you'll also want to take Almeria without actually having a claim on it and core it. This is gonna put you at odds with these guys, with Castile. Okay, let's see. Did anything change? No. This is gonna put you at odds with Castile, even actually killing your alliance with him. So you should probably improve relations with this guy, with Aragorn. So you can okay, there it is. So you can have a backup ally. You still have England as an ally, but they'll have the War of the Roses. They'll have wars against France. Right now they're only allied with Portugal. They're improving relations with Scotland. No. The other way around. The other way around. Which is gonna be trickier. They might... Let's see. In this mission, they might ally Austria, which is gonna safeguard them against England, because Austria is also rivaled with France, and you see the connection. Now, if you cannot use Castile into a war against either Morocco or, let's say, Telemchen, what's it called here? Telemchen. Usually you don't want to attack Telemchen, but you might want to take this here, their capital and a center of trade, so you can push more from Safi to Seville. If you have no target for Castile to waste your manpower on, kill your alliance with Castile and form the alliance with Aragon, or even an alliance with France if they rival Castile. But right now you can build 70 troops. Let's check out Aragon to see exactly how many troops they can have. Armies Aragon, they have 18,000 with a max proximity of 23, so basically they have 14,000 troops with the troops from Naples. You should probably be able to overwhelm Castile, especially because they have only two forts, a level 3 and level 2 fort. You should be able to easily conquer them. So if you have no target for Castile to spend their manpower on, like Morocco, don't ally them and ally instead Aragon. Now, if this happens and you want to target Castile, try to target them as fast as possible, even attacking, even actually making a claim on Seville, for example, and then attacking them instantly, like after the claim is done, so that they won't be able to form the PU over Aragon. Or even if they form the PU over Aragon, they'll have less lands, and they'll be hard pressed to keep Aragon in check. Because let's say you conquer Seville, and you take Seville for example, and then you basically give you humiliate them. Of course, you're gonna rival them because you can. You're gonna humiliate them and get war reparation. That's 50 war score with Seville. That's gonna be perhaps 15 war score, maybe 20 war score. You're gonna be left with a little bit, like what, 30 war score, and you can give I don't know, Soria. Should probably give them coastal lands, so you should probably give them Murcia and let's say Cuenca, basically. Try to leave them a land base or a sharing region, a sea region or border with France, so that they might get rivaled by France later on, if they're not dead by then. Also, right now they are rivaled with England, so you might be able to actually call England in. Yes, you can call England in. So there's gonna be basically England, Portugal and Aragon against Castile. You can basically squash this guy instantly. Like right now, I'm not gonna play this. Or actually I'm gonna play for like an hour and a half, the oil situation myself. So basically now, if you check it here, now I need 12 December, let's see. Well, Regency Council, so let's wait for the, you have to wait for the Regency Council to end, of course. But yeah, so your main steps are this. If you can, if Castile wants to take on Morocco, call them in, give them Melilla, you take Tangiers, complete this mission, you get 100 admin points. It's gonna be easily, you can easily court and choose with those points and have some more to increase your speed, that which you will get the admin tax. If this is not possible, go for Castile. You already have an alliance with England, you'll also have an alliance with Aragon. If Castile, if France rivals Castile, you can't actually rival France, so because you're already allied with England. But yeah, Aragon and England with you, together with you, you can easily squash Castile out. Now, after you have squashed Castile, if the first option with Morocco happens, it's gonna be like 1460, because you'll also want to take Granada before that. If not, it's gonna be instantly, like the moment the Infante Pedro gets off the Regency Council, you attack Castile with the help of Aragon and England. Sometimes you won't have Aragon, but most of the times you'll have England. Depends if England actually rivals Castile or not. Now, after you have squashed Castile, you take Seville, you get another war, you take more of Castile. Try to then attack Castile without calling in allies, because you can easily squash them. Or a better option is to actually forcefully vassalize them, or wait until an enemy releases Leon, for example. Or Galicia, do they have anything here else? No, they have only Leon and Galicia that can be spawned. Now, you might also want to actually spawn Leon yourself, vassalize Leon, then actually feed Leon Castilian lands. Another option would be to actually vassalize Castile feed Castilian lands to Aragon, or wait for Aragon to solo Castile, then that's not gonna be possible as well. Then release Castile from England. Like, it's a little bit tricky depending on how you can make it. Like, release Castile from England, then actually forcefully vassalize Castile, then feed them lands from Aragon. It's up to you how you do it. I recommend doing a half and half, basically releasing Leon and also releasing Leon and feeding Leon, as well as actually attacking and coring yourself, mostly the important lands, like the Seville, La Mancha, they have a gold mine, as well as coastal lands, because you'll get the increase in ships, and you'll need those ships to basically control the trade. Let's see, do they have anything else that is good to be taken here? Let's actually go for this. Yeah, basically the Seville and the La Mancha as well, and feed the rest of Leon, because La Mancha is really big, as you can see, or probably the Granada state, so you can actually feed them to feed the rest to Leon, and make sure you have a full state so you can maximize the states. Now, after you're thoroughly squashed, Castile and Aragon, it's the turn for France. You're gonna attack France probably in the 1530s, perhaps. If you actually want to rush the attack on France, it's possible. If you ally yourself with England and move from Leon, Cantabria, Biscayne, and Navarra, and take a border with France. It also depends on how good of a player you are, and how aggressive you are, and how many points you want to spend, and how many opportunities the AI will give you. Like, the more experience you have, the better you'll do. As with anything, the more experience you have, the better you'll do. Now, squashing France, you'll need to actually ally Austria. Perhaps they'll have the event. Oh shit! They'll have the event for Burgundy, so they'll have friction. So you can actually ally Austria and challenge the attacks of France. Right now in this playthrough, as you can see, these guys might ally themselves, Austria and England. So they're probably gonna have a triple alliance between England, Austria, and Portugal squashing France. France is gonna die really easily, especially if England hasn't lost their foothold into France. But this is for the basically mid game. As you can see, basically Portugal has only a straightway up that you can core. Basically, you can only go like this to the mid game, and probably advance into Italy and also the mid game if you move through Aragon to the Balearics to basically, what's this, Corsica and Sardinia, the Sardinia, right? Sardinia, sorry, Corsica and Sardinia. You'll move it probably into Corsica, or this is a, or you might actually want to risk it. For example, when you're at war with Aragon, basically directly take Sassari and move into Italy. As well, this depends on your own personality and how aggressive you are. If you actually seen one of my series, you'll see that I tend to basically be extremely aggressive and try to take hold of all the advantages that I can get. Now, this is for the early and mid game. You're probably gonna be in the 1600s by the time you move into perhaps half of no, I think you'll have the Genoa trade node in hand by the 1600s, and probably also the Bordeaux trade node, and some, maybe half of Venice, probably this half of Venice. It still depends on your situation, depending on how the Ottomans move, depending on how Austria moves. I cannot predict past the mid game because of this, because of the how the AI moves and how lucky you are and how unlucky is the AI. Now, for the colonization, it's the same as Castile's. You'll move to Cape Verde, if I haven't said this before, then to Brazil, then to this thing, the Caribbean. You will not want to actually form a colony in Brazil, and you'll want to directly form a colony in the Caribbeans, and then form one in Mexico to feed the Mexican lands. Sorry, god damn it, to feed the Mexican lands to your colony as well. Let's see, where is it? Colonial regions as well. As I said in the Castile video, form Mexico here and try to form the Caribbean with one province in every landmass. So basically, you have Havana, you have Les Cayes, or the one that has the most base text, for example. Let's see. This is Havana, and this is whatever it is. Let's say this is Les Cayes. You'll also want to take Jamaica. Try to aim for the ones that have the huge development, or the ones that have the trade nodes, the important natural harbor. As you can see them here, they have only two in this trade node, so you can have more of a push. Then you're gonna move your one of your merchants here, and you can push straight to Seville, as well as moving one guy here and pushing from this side here. Now, the colonization of this should be really easy. You won't have any rivals. In the early game, you don't have any rivals, especially if you attack Castile and you take the Canaries. I don't recommend taking the Canaries though, because you might actually want to use the expansion ideas of Castile to increase the speed that at which you actually form colonies. So Castile might be able to help you a little bit in your expansion. Now, after you've done this, expand some more here, form colonies here. Like the colony game, the colonization game is really easy in the Americas. It should be really straightforward, whether you play Castile or Portugal, so there shouldn't be any problems. Now, for Africa, same as last time, focus on the Ivory Coast trade node. Basically, everything pushes into Ivory Coast trade node, and you'll want to take these lands from Jolof and Mali. They're easily colorable. They don't have any bad modifiers, and same goes from the lands from Benin. And you'll also want to actually form colonies, one on Fernando Po, and the rest in Cape Verde, basically one in the Cape and one in the surrounding regions as well, so you can push. With this, if you act, you'll like to actually automatically push from Cape Verde without having a merchant, so you should be able to actually first form the Cape of Good Hope until you have a powerful army and cash, then move on to the rest of the lands here, basically into Zanzibar trade node, into the Malacca trade node as well, into the Moluccas trade node, into the Indies. This is gonna probably be past the 1550s, maybe 1600s, mainly because you won't have the manpower to actually attack all of these places. You'll have to actually have perhaps 25 ships to move your troops from one place to another efficiently, like moving troops for them from the Americas, the North Americas, to the Central Americas, to the South Americas, no, actually to the South America, Central America, North America, I said Americas, or to the African, the what's this, the West African or the South African here. To it's as I said in the Castile video, it's gonna be a really taxing on your mental power. Basically, you have to time your attacks really well and be really efficient so that you'll be able to actually conquer all of this land really fast. The second option, of course, is to actually do the what's called do the not tributaries, that's something else, the protectorates to get the trade power. I recommend doing this only in the trade nodes that you don't want to push through. Basically, for example, in the Timbuktu trade node, in the, let's say, in the Great Lakes trade node, in the Congo trade node, in the Zambezi trade node, let's see, in the Moluccas trade node, for example, in Australia, if somebody has it actually, yeah, in Australia you already push automatically. But mainly in trade nodes that you don't want to push automatically, where you push automatically, sorry. So here you push automatically, here you push automatically, here you push automatically. So you'll want to have full here, because this is your main line, of course. But you won't have to have full here because, I'm actually confusing you right now. How to explain this in a simpler way? Try to have full trade power or as much as possible in trade nodes that you want to push from, basically. That means Malacca, that means Ivory Coast, that means Caribbean, for example. All these trade nodes that have multiple ways of going, basically. Like, for example, the Caribbean can go into the Chesapeake Bay, can go into the Bordeaux trade node, and then can go into the Seville trade node. So you'll have to actually push into one of these nodes. So you want to have full power here, so you can push wherever you want to push. I hope this makes it clear. Now, this should be all. Try to be careful with papacy, as I said, in the Castile Neutral node, try to use the papacy as well. I haven't talked about it because you might actually not have that much papal influence as Castile, because they have the idea, and they'll have the cash to become the, what's it called, a defender of the faith. It still costs 500 gold, so they still have the cash to become the defender of the faith. So they have more power on the Curia as well. Also, I think you cannot actually fight for it right now. Yeah, you don't have any cardinals, so you can't actually fight for it now. The next cardinal... No, it should say somewhere. Yeah, next possible cardinals. Yeah, you basically even... You don't have a chance to actually have a cardinal, so... You'll probably have to take one from Castile. I don't know where that... Okay, Cardinal of Salamanca. And Salamanca is... here. So you might actually want to take Salamanca, so you'll have a cardinal here. Minor things that you'll gain with experience, of course. This is all. There's nothing much to say. Careful of your expansion into these lands. Here. I don't recommend expanding here unless you are at full points, or you are about to get the full points and you have to spend them and you don't want to waste them on getting tax or something else. Then you might want to actually expand into Morocco and Telemcen. Now, Telemcen, they're allied with Morocco. I did some tests beforehand, and they always, not always, but most of the time, allied themselves with Telemcen. So you're probably gonna have to fight... How many troops? Troops, yes. Morocco... Dude, yeah, I passed them. Really? No, you didn't pass them. You're just stupid. Okay, did I really pass them? No, I didn't pass them. God damn it. The fucking alphabet. Morocco, they have 14,000 troops with an 18,000 force limit. So basically they have the same force limit as you do. But they have the Telemcen ally who has... Let's see... Telemcen... Really? No. Did I pronounce it right? Come on. Telemcen, there you go. Telemcen, so it's TL. Telemcen, they have 8,000 to force limit of 10. So basically, if you can't call in Castile, do not attack Morocco. Like, this is a must. Make sure you have Castile when you attack Morocco, because you cannot deal with both Morocco and Telemcen. If you're smart, if you're good at your job, you might be able to attack Morocco and kill them without having to fight Telemcen. With your force limit and your extra tech, if you wait till you get tech 5 before they do, you'll have the extra military tactics, which is gonna give you, well, plenty of damage to kill them. Also, it's gonna increase your siege potential, if I'm not mistaken. Siege speed, not potential. Yeah, also, one more thing. Tunis might get an alliance with the Ottomans. Right now, they don't have an alliance with the Ottomans. Do I actually still have the fucking Yes Man? I must have fucked around the Yes Man, so that's why they improving relations with Austria. for some actual reason they won't be able to get an alliance with Austria. Do they actually have a mission? No, they don't, so I don't know what's happening, to be honest. It might be from the Yes Man stuff, which fucks around with their rivals and their, what's it called, their improving of relations and alliances. Yeah, be careful of Tunis, they might grow really big, they might pose a problem if you don't expand really fast, or you expand into Morocco and they expand that into Lemchen. Also, note this, you might be able to attack Morocco if the Lemchen is at war with Tunis and they call in Morocco, basically, weakening them. Be careful of opportunities, like, this is the best thing I can tell you to do. Be careful of opportunities in this game, like, also always check your next door neighbors or your potential targets, or your allies, the allies of your potential targets, because it might surprise you if you keep an eye on your enemies and the friends of your enemies. You might be surprised of what opportunities you can get from keeping a tab out, you keeping an eye out on this kind of things. This is gonna be all. You won't have any problems with aggressive expansion, most likely, mainly because you're gonna be allied with England and Aragon when you attack Castile. So for the early to mid game, aggressive expansion won't be a problem at all, to be honest, unless you get really greedy and you take full land from Castile and you won't have an alliance, the same alliance with Aragon, or you don't keep your opinion up with Aragon. Right now you have the better relations over time, plus 20%, sorry, which is really gonna help you. Like, you shouldn't be afraid of aggressive expansion. This is not this is gonna be a trench warfare, to be honest. Like, Portugal on the mainland, it's just basically trench warfare. Like, take a piece of land, fortify it, core it, go at it again, take another piece of land, core it, go at it again. Like, you don't have avenues of expansion that are really important, except of course actually colonization, but this is not my mainland expansion, and they can only give you cash, they cannot give you actual troops, boots on the ground, basically, so you can fight more wars or keep your colonies in check. So be mindful of your cash. As I said at the start, you don't have that much. Like, right now you have basically 0.72. If I try to be at war, you have minus 80. If I try to build some troops to max out my army force limit, let's see, to max out your army force limit, you will need one of these and two of these. So basically you're running out of cash and you still have two slots, so you can build basically two troops. You might actually want to ask for contributions, and they're gonna allow you to build one more guy, basically, so you can actually max out your force limit if you want to attack Castile. But you'll have to get loans to maintain this status. Also, try to maximize your army. Like, don't build your max force limit right now unless you have max manpower or you have impending war, basically. Like, build up your maximum force limit 3 months. Not 3 months. What's the build time for a knight? They don't say. Actually, let's check it. It's gonna be built in 12th of March, so that's what, December, sorry, March, so 1 month for the calf, so basically 2 months before, actually two, no, if you unite your troops, you should be fine on morale. Like, if you move your troops here, and you're keeping them at, they're probably at half morale, then you build these troops here, and you measure them, you're gonna have, enough morale to recuperate in 2 months. So basically 2 months before the declaring war on Castile, try to build your troops. That's the best option to maximize your cash efficiency. And this is it. I don't think I actually forgot something. Did I actually forgot something else? Not really. Yep, this is it. Like, this is it. There's nothing much else to say. Make sure you get the general trainer as soon as possible. And attack Castile as well, as soon as possible, so they won't get the PO over Aragon. So the time of the PO over Aragon is 1450. Like, and you will have to manually check for the conditions for it to happen. So this guy and this guy are gonna die probably in 20 years, and this guy is still young, so he's gonna live for some time. So you're probably gonna be safe for the first 20 years, I say. Once this guy dies, this guy might die instantly. So try to actually, you cannot do it for this. This is really annoying. Like, I cannot right click on that. Probably so I have to go from here to actually to make this special interest. You want to check for the death of their rulers, this ruler and their heir, and check for the female heirs or regency. Like, if you see a female heir or regency, make sure you can go at war against Castile and call in Aragon, because if they are at war, the event won't happen. Especially if it's a regency. Like, if it's a regency, try to call in Aragon and drag the war as much as possible, so that the event won't happen. Because the mean time for the event, it's 1 year. So basically, if there's a regency or a female ruler on either of the thrones, the event is gonna fire. Like, 100% sure, unless like the RNG is really in your favor. And usually you should not actually rely on RNG. You should never rely on RNG in this game, because the moment you rely on RNG, this game is gonna be lost for you. This game is gonna be over for you. Oh. And if you look here, yeah, you have 80 days for the buildup of these troops. Yeah, 80 days, so 2 months. So basically build them actually, yeah. No, I was wrong. So as you can see, I was wrong. I can be wrong sometimes. So basically build them 3 months before you declare war when you, to actually remember it, when you actually move the army maintenance up, you start building the troops, because the timing should be the same. With this, I bid you farewell. If you like the videos, consider subscribing or liking it. It will really help me develop my channel, because right now I have 2 subscribers. And I really want to see it grow. Like, I really like playing Year 4, and at some point I actually lost my the drive to play Year 4, because I played all over this damn goddamn place. Like, the sheer amount of times I played England, it's phenomenal. Like, I will talk about the England and how you should play England the pro way, and you should be surprised of what you can accomplish with England by the 1500s. You should really be surprised. Anyway, again, I bid you farewell. I hope you enjoyed this, and I'll see you next time, where I really don't know what's gonna be next. I think it's France next on the line. The actual order of the nations are the nations that are in the start screen. When you actually select the country or which you want to play, you can select you'll see the 8 nations, if I'm mistaken, 8 or 9 nations, and you can actually, you'll see the line there. After this line is done of countries, I'm gonna go with one country on each continent. So I'll probably go left first, then go for the Aztecs, then Cusco, then go for, say, Mali or Timbuktu. Then this area here, then probably the Arabian Peninsula, and in India, then in here, then you already know here. But I'll still talk about the Manchu tribes a little bit, probably in I'll still talk about them. I'll talk about them for a half an hour at a whole. I already have the Manchu what's it called, the Manchu Bliss play, which really showcases the power of the Manchu tribes. But yes, for a third time, I'm gonna bid you farewell, and hope I'll see you next time. Bye, guys.